This week on Maker Update, Flappy Bird rides again, a single-piece 3D printed watercraft, stained glass imperial armor, and making rigid structures out of cardboard. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update, the show where we find all the coolest stuff that makers are making and share them with you so you can stay inspired and make cool projects all of your own. I'm Tyler Weingartner and I hope you're all doing great. We've got a wonderful show for you, so let's get started with the project of the week. Do you miss Flappy Bird, the super frustrating mobile game that was available for just a few months and then removed by its creator because it was too addictive? If you do, then you're in luck, because Engineezy misses it too. And that's why he's created this all-mechanical version of it. And he wants it to be as accurate as possible, including both the unique motion of the bird, as well as the random position of the pipes it needs to fly through. The first thing to be solved is the conveyor for the pipes. You might not think it until you try, but creating a cart that can move on both a straight and a curved section of the track is easier said than done. The pipes move up and down on these tracks to create this random positioning thanks to a servo motor. But all those motors need power. To avoid having to wire up each one individually and risk the wires getting twisted up or caught on something, he's powering each cart through an electrified track, similar to slot cars. The bird's movement is its own unique collection of challenges. The primary mechanism is a bit like the pipe mechanism, only now he's using stepper motors for more precise and faster control. To vary the bird's rotation, he's using a bistable mechanical switch that's triggered by a solenoid. The bird is mounted magnetically to facilitate the game over state. When it hits an obstacle, the bird will fall to the ground, opening a circuit and triggering the game over event. And I'm only scratching the surface of the interesting problems and challenges with this build. There are so many other cool details, like using mechanical chimes for the sound effects, or this split flap score display, and this panel that slides away to reveal the game over screen. The project is amazing, the build is wild, and because he shares all of his mistakes, as well as his inspirations for the mechanisms, it's a great opportunity to learn as well. More projects. The folks at Proper Printing have created an entirely 3D printed single-piece kayak, and they set themselves up with an almost impossible challenge, to have it finished by the time of Maker Faire Prague so they could demonstrate it for the first time in front of everyone. To pull this off, they've created a massive belt printer based off of a treadmill. That way they'd not only have the width necessary for the kayak, but also the length. But even still, it's a massive print, and the deadline is rapidly approaching. Like with any experimental printer, they encountered a few misprints, so they had to restart. And with the restarts, it wouldn't finish on time. Which is when things get a little crazy. Under the guidance of Ivan Miranda, they were able to pause the print and then tweak a few settings in the G-code to help speed up the print before it resumed. This is an epic journey in experimental 3D printing, and you don't want to miss it. Ali Spagnola has teamed up with Bill Duran of Punished Props to create an automata icon to her philosophy in life. You gotta keep moving before it all gets you down. And her version of this is an animatronic shark that swims when she turns a crank on the base. The shark begins as a sculpture in clay that's 3D scanned using photogrammetry so that Bill can add the mechanical bits to make the shark swim. Bill is plenty present in this video, but he also has his own video covering his part of the process. And from Walter Freeman Productions, we have this video on how he made this stained glass Tiffany style lamp in the design of a Stormtrooper helmet from Star Wars. I'd never heard the term Tiffany style in this context, but I love the look because it reminds me of the lamps from pizza parlors from the 80s. His work process is laying out the glass and soldering it together over a model of the helmet itself. This process means breaking up the work into multiple pieces so we can pull them off the mold and assemble them later. It's a painstaking but gorgeous build, and you can see the whole thing come together in the video. But be forewarned, there's an awful lot of cursing in it, so maybe don't watch this with your kids. Time for some tips and tools from NightHawkInLight. We have a great video on how to make rigid, waterproof structures from cardboard. His technique involves laminated corrugated sheets together in alternating directions for maximum rigidity. His favorite glue to use is simple wheat paste. And don't miss this tip on how to seal over the corrugated edge, or incorporating other materials like wood to add strength to the skeleton when needed. You can also build up a ton of strength using basic papier-mâché techniques. Lots of cool stuff here. Jeff Geerling is stepping away from single board computers for a moment to help you get your first foothold with microcontrollers. He is likening this journey to a circuit toy he played with as a kid, and his closest analog is this collection of components connected to a Raspberry Pi Pico called PicoBricks. PicoBricks has its own ecosystem with a visual block-based coding interface that makes it easy for you to get started. On YouTube, I found this video by Animotion for various gate latching techniques. And to start, yes, this video is all CG. But nonetheless, this is a great collection of self-latching mechanisms that are easy to release, and you should be able to recreate them in a number of different manufacturing techniques. And finally, we have a video from Federico Tobon for Cuttle about how to break up the designs for laser cutting when they're too large to fit on your cutting bed. His first examples cover the basics, splitting the design on an orthogonal axis. But then he shows how to use various shapes as cutout patterns to make it easier to key more complex parts together. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, they have a brand new video series about how to get started with KiCad 9. KiCad 9 released earlier this year with a huge emphasis on usability improvements. So if you've been intimidated before, now might be the right time to jump in. There's two episodes in this series already, with plenty more to come. Check it out. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. Thank you so much for being here and for sharing all of your maker stories with us. A reminder, as always, you can get more info about every single one of these projects by following the links down in the description. While you're there, leave us a comment, give us a thumbs up, and hit subscribe so you don't miss the next one. Huge thanks, as always, to DigiKey for making this show possible and to you for watching. Take care. We'll see you soon.